Hi everyone, happy Monday. It's great to be back after a week off. Hope you guys had a great Thanksgiving. It's a gorgeous day here. I think it's supposed to be about 75, maybe 80 degrees. We've had a string of windy and warm weather the past week. So the garden is just not sure what to do. So hope you guys are doing well. Had a restful week, and we are gonna have a great live stream today. We're gonna talk about three plants that you can plant in your garden that help deter insects and creepy crawlies. I know it's a huge issue for most of us. Someone in the poll ahead of the live stream mentioned that they were the only pests they have in, I think it was my backyard gourds, that the only pest in her garden right now is about a foot of snow. So hopefully you're not in that situation. But if you are, you're gonna know what to plant when that snow melts. And Nisha's here. I didn't think she was gonna be able to join us today. She's on a trip to a super fun place. She's in Zurich. And so Nisha, glad you could chime in. I have absolutely no idea what the time difference is. Hopefully it's not too late. And then Cliff is here, our other moderator. So glad to have both of you along. So let me just scroll through the chat here and say hello. It was great to see everyone in the pre-chat. And let's see, in the pre-live stream chat. And Connie Graham is here from Oregon. Almost made it to the Mandarin Festival. I hope it went well. Connie, that would have been awesome to see you, but maybe next year. And yes, you guys, the Mandarin Festival went absolutely fantastic. In fact, we were so busy, we didn't even have time to do a lot of filming. So Jerry actually did a live stream on his Instagram on Saturday. I think a few of you were able to catch that. But we were just so blessed to have so many of you come by and see us. I think it was busy from morning until night, all 3 days of the festival. And people just kept coming up to us and introducing themselves and sharing their garden stories, how gardening has changed their lives, how they were inspired to garden during the pandemic because of our videos. And it was just so meaningful to Jerry and I to meet so many of you. So I'm so sorry that we were not able to get more video. We took as many pictures as we could, but it was hard to get people's names and then put it with the picture that we had. So we got a little bit mixed up with that, but we did our best. So anyway, thank you guys so much. It's great to be back. And while we're on the topic of live streaming, we are not, December is a little bit of a different schedule. There's no live stream next week on December 6th. And there's also no live stream on December 29th. So we're taking a couple of weeks off in there. The entire December live stream schedule will be posted in the video description. So I saw Jack is here from Maryland. You've had a lot of wind there as well, Jack. And I know your greenhouse kind of got thrashed. So sorry about that. Hopefully you're able to salvage some of it. Gardening with Russ, aphids in the greenhouse. So yeah, there's a lot of pest issues going around in the garden. And the plants behind me here are nasturtiums. It's one of the things that we're gonna talk about today. So let's jump in. And in between the plants I'm gonna share, we'll take your questions, comments, and give a couple more announcements throughout the live stream here. So thanks a lot for joining me. So pests in the garden are a huge, huge issue, but there are some plants that you can interplant with your vegetables. So interplant means kind of put these plants next to your vegetables to help deter the pests. And usually this works in a couple of different ways. The plants that we're going to talk about today, most of them have a strong scent or a strong odor. And what that does is mask the scent of the host plant. For example, tomatoes have a strong scent that the hornworms like. Sometimes spider mites and aphids will attack your tomato plants. And if you plant certain plants around that, it will mask the scent of the tomatoes and confuse the pests. So they either land on the deterrent crop or they go somewhere else. So these particular plants can act as a deterrent by masking the scent, or they can act as a trap crop. And for example, the first category that we're gonna dig into of plants that you can put in your garden to help deter insects from your vegetable garden are flowers. And flowers, one of my favorites is right behind me here, nasturtiums. They're super, super easy to grow. They like cool weather temperatures, so I'm kind of surprised that mine are popping up here in the garden because we've had 80, 85 degree temperatures. But despite that, they're popping up. They do have a really strong scent. They're kind of a peppery flavor. But the thing about nasturtiums are that aphids sometimes are attracted to nasturtiums. So you can plant them around plants that usually attract aphids, like the brassicas, your broccoli, cauliflower, kale, collards, some of those plants. And what happens is the nasturtiums will tend to hide underneath, the aphids will tend to hide underneath the nasturtium leaves rather than getting down in your broccoli, a crop that you would really harvest a lot of and eat a lot of. Bye, Nisha. See you later. Thanks a lot for joining us for a little bit. So you know what? You don't want to be too upset when you see aphids on your nasturtiums, because nasturtiums usually grow in profusion like they do behind me here, and usually can sacrifice a few to the aphids to keep them off your broccoli and cabbage, which are a lot more difficult to grow. So some other flowers that work really well as pest deterrents are borage. Is actually an herb, but it's a gorgeous, gorgeous flower. It also attracts beneficial insects to your garden, which can be natural predators to pests such as aphids. Max just kind of walking back and forth here. But it's the scent of borage can also repel the insects that you don't want around too, like the tomato hornworm. So I like to plant borage around my tomato plants, not only for the pollinators, but also as a pest deterrent. A couple of other great flowers to plant for pest deterrents are calendula and marigolds. So the calendula especially attract the aphids. If you've ever grown calendula, you know that a lot of times they do get covered with aphids. So it's a good idea to plant those around the aphid attracting crops. Again, the brassicas, particularly susceptible to aphids. So those are just some flowers, one category of plants that you can plant in your garden once your vegetable garden starts going strong again in the spring, or in southern climates right now, get a lot of these flowers planted. Now, some that will work really well in southern climates are the cool weather flowers. Like I mentioned, calendulas and the nasturtiums are great cool weather flowers. So I've got those in my cool weather flower, cool season, bring on the pollinators flower collection. And some of the warm weather flowers, like the borage, are in the Bring on the Pollinators Warm Season Flower Collection. So if you need seeds, I would love for you to grab these over at calicumgardenandhome.com. And today happens to be Cyber Monday. We're continuing on with the Black Friday sale, 30% off with the code HOLIDAY off everything on my website. And that sale does end tomorrow. And it is the deepest discount I will have for the Christmas season. So grab your flowers and get some planted to help deter those insects from your garden. Now, that being said, is that by planting some of these crops is not a guarantee that you won't have insects, but it definitely, the scent of those flowers and the oils of some of those flowers will help deter some of those insects from your garden. And we all can use all the help that we can get with keeping the insects and the creepy crawlies out of our garden. Okay, back to the chat, and let's hear what questions you might have, and also some other flowers that you planted in your garden that you find either are a trap crop or their scent helps mask the crop of the vegetables that you want to grow and harvest a lot more of than you want to give up to the pests. Okay, Patricia, how you doing there? Said that she loves that collection, the Bring on the Pollinators collection, and have already started planting the flowers. That's great, Patricia. Great to hear. You're in Arizona, so in your southern climate, you've got plenty of time to plant. Now, a little note here on the nasturtiums. They are not frost tolerant unless you have them in a very protected location of your yard. They will shrivel up and die if they're touched by frost. So we don't often get frost here in Southern California, but if I do, my nasturtiums just kind of go whoop and just kind of fall over. But the cool thing is they reseed, they drop their seeds from year to year, and they pop up very quickly if they do die off from the cold. So thank you very much, Pure Pondering. Your nasturtiums are beautiful. Yeah, super thrilled with how early they're coming up this year. Just this beautiful green blanket right behind me. And the spot behind me here hardly gets any sun this time of the year. So it does take them a little bit more time to bloom, because they bloom much better in full sun. But if you saw my Instagram picture this morning, I posted a beautiful photo of some bright orange nasturtiums that are in a sunny spot right over here that are blooming absolutely beautifully. So southern gardeners, get your nasturtiums planted. Northern gardeners, plant them after your last frost date of the wintertime in the springtime. Okay, let's see here. Any other comments here in the chat? Thank you, Cliff, very much for posting the Black Friday sale. Tanya, how are you doing? Kim, this is a great question. Do you plant in the same container if container planting or just near each other? I do like to plant nasturtiums, particularly in containers, because they kind of spill over the containers. So they're really easy to plant with other crops. You might be growing a tomato plant in the middle or some other type of plant in the middle. Plant your nasturtiums, they kind of trail over the edge. And I usually do try, if I'm planting calendulas, I usually will try and plant a couple right in the same container. But you know what? It doesn't really matter. If you plant them near each other, you can plant a separate container right near each other, or kind of border your garden bed with them. And that's kind of what's called interplanting. In other words, you're mixing your crops. You're not just planting all of your tomatoes or just tomatoes in your garden bed. You're kind of intermixing some of your crops. Marigolds, your crops, your flowers, your herbs, that type of thing. Marigolds are a great edging flower, and they're also a good pest deterrent because they have a super strong scent as well. So any of these plants that we're talking about today, just interplant them however you can, mix them in with your vegetables. Again, not only do they bring in the pollinators, but they'll help mask the scent of the plants that you want to harvest as well. Okay, question here from Hindi. What is the white stuff on my strawberry plant? I transplanted it 2 months ago and I've noticed some white stuff on the leaves. Thanks for your help, Kim. Enjoyed the latest podcast. It could possibly be powdery mildew of some kind. It's kind of hard to tell without seeing it, but you can get powdery mildew on your strawberry leaves. It could also be some other type of disease, but what I would definitely do is trim off those affected leaves as soon as you can and spray them down with some type of fungicide like a neem oil or something like that. Okay, we're going to jump into the next plant. Oh, and speaking of, you said that you enjoyed the latest podcast, which thank you very much. I wanted to announce that as well. The latest episode dropped this morning. So go over to gardeningcoasttocoast.net and check that out. This is probably one of my favorite episodes thus far. Gary and I had a great time recording it. It's all about gardening to beat the winter blues, gardening for mental health, really just using your garden in different ways to help you get through those long winter months. We talked about this on a live stream actually maybe a month or so ago, and we had such a good response from that we decided to do a podcast on it. So please go over to gardeningcoasttocoast.net, check out that latest episode. It's also on iTunes, Spotify, just about anywhere that you can listen to your podcast. And Jack, great question. Will the rest of the podcast be on YouTube? We also just, thanks Jack for bringing that up. We also just posted our first podcast in video format over the weekend. And that was the one that Camera Guy was the guest on. So we are working hard to get most of our podcasts, or at least in future episodes, up on YouTube, but it's gonna take us a little bit of time just due to time constraints to get that done. We're hoping that we can, but it will usually be a week or two after it uploads in the podcast world. But hope you guys enjoyed that. It was kind of fun for us to look back and see how things look when we're recording a podcast. So hopefully you enjoyed that as well. And I know Camera Guy actually showed his cameras a couple of times and things like that. So it's kind of good to have a visual on what we're talking about on the audio versions too. So please let us know how you're liking those. Okay, Angela says, I saw that one yesterday. It was fun to watch. That's great. Glad to hear it. And My Backyard Gourd says, I found that calendula can take full sun, full shade, and everywhere in between. And I haven't had to buy any seeds for about 5 years. So many free seeds from each plant. That is so true. They're a super hardy flower. They will take some heat as well. Although I've kind of found that when the heat comes, the pests kind of come in and attack the calendula plants, which it can be a trap crop as well. And the heat kind of just makes them kind of wilt and not look so great. But they are definitely a long blooming flower, and you can save the seeds from that. And they are just a gorgeous orange, beautiful flower as well. Hi, Jackie. How's it going today? Thanks for joining us. Okay, next plant that you can put in your garden to deter the pests and the creepy crawlies are herbs. So it's kind of a category of plant, just like flowers was kind of a category. So herbs also have a very, very strong scent, and they're very high in essential oils. So what you wanna do when you're walking by your herbs is just kind of run your fingers over your herbs, which will release the natural oils, the natural scent of the plants, and that will help mask the scent of whatever host crops that the aphids or other pests or creepy crawlies tend to attack. So some really good herbs for that. Besides the fact that they're a really good food source for beneficial insects, especially once they start to bloom. So some great herbs that are very full of aroma that are great for this are sage, dill, basil, thyme, and rosemary. So pretty much all my favorite herbs. Get as many herbs planted as you can. The dill especially has the odor that will, the cabbage moths will help kind of push those away. So, you know, those crazy little cabbage moths that kind of flit around. I mean, you think they're nice, cute little white butterflies, but what they actually do is lay little eggs on your plants, and that's how you get the little green little cabbage looper worms that can decimate some of your crops. So I know the right now I've got cabbage looper holes on my broccoli and my cauliflower, so I will definitely be planting some dill, since hopefully the weather will be getting cooler. Some dill will grow really well in the cooler temperatures. Parsley is also a good one for that. So plant as many herbs as you can. Now, I do have a dedicated herb garden. A lot of you might have watched my video on planting a kitchen herb garden. I like to grow those right up near my house. But I also do try and plant herbs throughout my garden, in between my tomato plants. Now, it has been said that basil will kind of mask the scent of tomatoes and help deter the tomato hornworm. So we had a few hornworms this summertime. So next year, I'm going to be planting a lot more basil in between my tomatoes. So a lot of these things, guys, you just kind of want to experiment, because different things will work in different areas depending on the type of pest that you have. But any of these herbs that are highly, highly aromatic are a great crop or plant to interplant with your vegetables, and it really will help deter and mask the scent of those tomatoes and all those vegetables that you really want to harvest. So let me see if I had anything else to say about herbs here. I think what I mentioned is the scent really does interfere with the laying of eggs. So what happens is the cabbage moths come and they are kind of confused when they try and land, say, on your broccoli. They're kind of confused. They're like, okay, where's that broccoli scent? I'm not finding that the smell of that broccoli plant that I want to lay my eggs on. Instead, they're smelling the beautiful scent of the basil or of the thyme or of the rosemary or the oregano, and they might go somewhere else and lay their eggs. So we want to confuse them as much as we can so they don't land on the plants and the crops that we want to eat and they go somewhere else. Okay, back into the chat. Let's see if we can answer some more questions. Let me know what herbs that you've planted and interplanted with your vegetables that have really worked well for you in deterring some of the pests that we don't want in our garden. Okay, Mr. Gromby, hi, how are you today? I don't know if I've ever seen you in the chat here before, so welcome if this is your first live stream. So glad that you're here. And Mr. Gromby says, I like planting tons of herbs in my garden. Seems to do the trick with preventing most critters. Absolutely. The more aromatic type of plants that you can plant in your garden, the more critters and creepy crawlies you're gonna deter. Now, the next plant I'm gonna mention is not on the list, but I have noticed, and maybe you have too, that most of the critters, the squirrels, and the rodents and things like that tend to leave the hot peppers alone. I don't have any real scientific proof for that, but I don't often see a bite taken out of a hot pepper plant. So that's also another plant that you can interplant in your garden to help keep the, you know, the squirrels and the rodents out as well. Yes, absolutely. Also marigolds, mint, basil, lavender off the top of my head. Absolutely. Those are all good herbs to plant there. Okay, Vicky says, we have a white butterfly that lays eggs which end up hatching army worms, but I have found fescue grass is not liked, so you don't have eggs laid on them. Hey, that's great. I love hearing about that. I've never planted fescue grass before. Is that just like the fescue that you would have in your lawn, or is that a different type of grass? But that's something that you might want to then, if army worms are an issue for you, then plant around Maybe border some of your vegetable garden beds with that to help keep them out. So that's awesome. Okay, let's see what else is here in the chat before we move on to our third category here. Okay, Hindi360 says, do chives serve as a deterrent? I haven't had any success starting chives from seed. Have you? Also wanted to say you and Gary make a great team of teachers. Love learning from you both. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. We do enjoy teaching together, so it's a lot of fun. And chives, yes, they are also on the list as a pest deterrent. Chives tend to attract the little black, I think they're flea beetles, the little teeny tiny black bugs. So they're not aphids, but I think they're flea beetles. And also they do have a strong scent. So they can help deter pests from your garden. And don't give up on planting chives from seed. You know, sometimes it might be a little bit too hot or a little bit too cold when you plant them from seed. It might take a little bit of time to get established. You may want to get some started indoors to get them off to a quick start. They do transplant very, very easily. You can start them like in a tray, even a to-go container, just seed them in there, you know, and put them under grow lights. You can either seed them in a tray and put them outside in the sun and then transplant them, you know, when they get to be a few inches or so tall. Okay, Sarah, question. Do you usually direct sow your nasturtiums? Yes, I do. They germinate very, very easily. They don't like hot temperatures. They do like around, you know, under 75 degrees, but they seed very, very easily and reseed very, very easily. If you've ever grown nasturtiums, you know they drop seeds absolutely everywhere. So you can collect your own seeds, save them for next year, or just, you know, let them grow again next year. Usually don't ever have to plant nasturtiums twice. So yeah, they are one of the easiest flowers in the world to grow here in my climate and in most climates too, I believe. And I also did want to mention that if you're looking for herb seeds, I do have an herb seed collection with 6 different varieties. So pretty much if you want to grow a different particular category, I've got that category in a seed collection on my website. We have 23 seed collections now. Would you believe I started off with just wanting to have 5 seed collections, and over the years it's grown. So they're arranged by type of vegetable, herb, flowers, or by growing season such as spring garden, fall garden, container garden. So stock up on your seeds for spring. The seeds will be good for several years, but definitely well into the spring, and for your Christmas gifts for your garden friends as well. And I also wanted to mention a great resource when it comes to companion planting, which is basically what we're talking about today, is this book called Plant Partners. I've been reading this book. It's a great book. It's really scientific based. And this is actually written by a friend of mine, Jessica Walliser, who happens to be my editor with Cool Swing Press, who is the publishing company where both of my books are published from. So she is an awesome gardener and really a scientist, wrote this book. So I would highly recommend this. You can find the link in the video description. So very good for wintertime reading. Okay, third category of a great companion plants for the garden is garlic and onions. And I think that Cliff kind of mentioned this before. Garlic and onions have such a pungent aroma. I don't want to say odor because I like the smell of garlic and onions, but they have such a pungent aroma, and they do tend to, you know, they might give us bad breath, keep the vampires away, but they also keep the pests away as well. So garlic is great for repelling, or both garlic and onions are great for repelling aphids, cabbage moths, which we already talked about, Japanese beetles, carrot flies, which if you've ever had carrot flies, actually have some little carrots coming up right behind me there. They just make a nasty mess of your carrots. So maybe plant some garlic and onions in the same container. Plant them in the, I like to plant garlic in containers because it's just, you know, nice loose soil. The garlic tends to bulb up a lot easier for me. So maybe plant a container of garlic next to your carrots or in the same garden bed, whichever works best for you. The same thing with onions. And that goes kind of with anything in the allium family, it's called. So garlic, onions, chives. This could even be like green onions or shallots. Anything in that allium family will really help deter those pests as well. And you're gonna get some great garlic and onions out of it too, because garlic does take a long time to grow, but things like green onions and chives take a relatively short period of time to sprout and grow. So that's a good thing to get planted. Garlic you can plant right now in southern climates or northern climates. If your ground isn't completely frozen, you can get your garlic in or plant in a container. As far as onions go, you can actually start your seeds indoors now, pretty much wherever you live, because they do, as far as bulbing onions, because they do take a long time to reach maturity. And you can grow them for, you know, 12 to even 16 weeks, 3 or 4 months indoors before you get them planted outside. So wintertime is actually a really good time to get your onions started indoors. And I'm actually hoping to do a video on growing onions in the next month or so, because there's different kinds of onions that work better depending on what area of the country you live in, depending on the hours of daylight that you get in your particular area. There's short day, long day, and intermediate day onions. So you wanna pick the kind that work best in your area. But definitely plant your garlic and onions to help keep the insects and deter the insects away from your garden. Okay, so we basically have three different categories of plants. We have our herbs, our flowers, and our alliums, our garlic and onions, that help deter pests from your garden. So if you can kind of work on interplanting these crops as you're planning for your spring garden, or if you're planting now in a southern climate, intersperse a few of these throughout your garden beds. Hopefully it will really help you have less pests over the long run. So let me hear from you in the chat if you have any other tips about good pest deterrents for your garden, because we can all definitely use some more help in that category. Okay, let's see here. Terry says, I have kept the garlic away from the other plants because I didn't want the bugs to hop to them. Learn something new, thanks. Yeah, that is one of the things that could possibly be a trap crop, which, you know, like I mentioned earlier, sometimes people might get a little bit upset when they see aphids all over their nasturtiums. But if you think about it, that's actually a good sign, because it means that the aphids aren't infesting the other plants that you might be eating more. Because I can put a few nasturtium leaves in my salads, pop them in smoothies. They're kind of a peppery, zippy flavor, but there's absolutely no way I'm gonna eat as many nasturtiums as I have right here, and I have nasturtiums all over my garden. So if you plant a bunch of them, I guess that might be a good little tip too, is plant extra for the pests. That way you're not so disappointed and discouraged when the pests are attacking your plants, because you have a lot more where those come from. Okay, let's see here. Vicky says, when I moved to this house, the previous owner had planted onions on the side of the porch. I started a container garden and have had very little problem with pests. That is awesome to hear that. I love that kind of feedback. So yeah, plant, if you don't have room for full-size onions, plant the little bunching onions or the green onions. Or a little tip, you guys, you can grab those green onions from the grocery store. Once you have harvested the tops, you can actually plant those in the soil for a quick growing pest deterrent, and then you've got some green onions as well, and they grow forever. I had some, I think I pulled them out now, but I grew them for years, and they're green onions that I grabbed at the grocery store, and you can even put them on your windowsill and snip off the tops to use in your recipes. So they are so, so easy to grow. Okay, let's see here. Amy, I have a lot of roly-polies. How do you deter them from munching on seedlings and plants? That's a great question, Amy. What I've done in the past, and everyone feel free to chime in here, is I have put little water bottles, like you cut off the bottom of them, or use toilet paper rolls. And when I plant my seedlings, I put that kind of as a little tube around my seedling, put my seedling in the middle as kind of a little barrier to help keep the roly-polies from munching on the stems of your seedling. So give that a try and let me know how it works. Okay, let's see here. Any other comments? Thank you very much, Hindi. I'm glad that the worm castings are working for you. Yeah, if you can get your plants healthier by putting all the beneficial bacteria that worm castings have in them, watering with worm tea, healthy plants will not attract pests as much either. So hopefully with all of these different things thrown in there, your plants are going to be healthy, and a sick plant will tend to attract pests a lot more than a healthy plant. Okay, let me scroll through the chat here, see if we have any more comments before we sign off today. I'm gonna log off just a little bit early today. I got a couple things I need to take care of before things get too far into the afternoon. So let's see here. Every time I plant a seedling, I dig up a bunch of grubs. I've never had them in my soil like this. Some big suckers too, ick. Oh yeah, those grubs can be absolutely crazy. And if anyone has any great suggestions for getting rid of them, I know a lot of people just kind of pick them out of the soil, feed them to their chickens. It's actually not a bad thing when you see them in your compost, because it does tend to help speed up the decomposition process. So not a big deal on that one. So hopefully we've got some good tips in here that can help you guys out with that. Well, guys, I'm going to go ahead and sign off for today. Thank you so much for hanging out with me. This has been a ton of fun. Let me know down in the comments once this video uploads what tips you found particularly helpful. Don't forget to check out the Gardening Coast to Coast podcast. The brand new one just dropped. And please take advantage of the Black Friday sale with the code HOLIDAY over at CaliKimGardenAndHome.com. Yeah, fry up those grubs for snacks. Yeah, funny. I want to hear if anybody tries that. Don't forget, we're off next week. We'll be back again in 2 weeks. And thanks a lot for joining us. Have a great couple of weeks. We'll see you later, guys. Bye-bye.